Regarde-moi juste.
Look at me. I'm scared because I'm a foreigner, even though I was born here. Le Pen tells me I'm only French on paper, but I'm French. That's why I'm scared.
And it's Friday, so David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart weigh in on America's increasingly bitter culture wars and the confusion over changing COVID masking rules. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
The landscape has changed, and not for the last time. The rules of business are being reinvented with a more flexible workforce, by embracing innovation, by looking not only at current opportunities, but ahead to future ones. Resilience is the ability to pivot again and again for whatever happens next.
People who know BDO.
Pediatric surgeon, volunteer, topiary artist, a Raymond James financial advisor tailors advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Russia has admitted for the first time that last week's sinking of its flagship cruiser, the Moskva, left dozens missing and one dead, although it still denies Ukraine attacked the ship. On the battlefront, Ukrainian officials claim Russian troops are redeploying from the southern port city of Mariupol to reinforce their new onslaught in the east. In the meantime, Ukraine says it sent a nighttime helicopter to deliver arms to the last Ukrainian forces in Mariupol who are holed up inside a giant steel facility. Villa Marx begins our coverage.
In the city of Mariupol, ghostly remnants of a relentless war. This is what Russia calls liberation. Apartment blocks battered by shelling, devoid of residents. The only signs of life, pro-Russian rescue workers locating the dead. They load people's remains onto trucks marked with Z, a symbol of Vladimir Putin's brutal invasion. The dead's destination for now, unknown. Today, a Ukrainian regional governor still seemed optimistic about Mariupol's future.
I unequivocally believe that Russians can be defeated. They are not taught to lose, but they overestimate themselves.
The last few Ukrainian fighters are bunkered down in a steel plant by the sea. Russian forces say they'll no longer try to storm that facility, but instead will besiege it. British officials say it's likely Russia prefers simply to surround it, to free up their forces for operations elsewhere. On social media channels, pro-Kremlin propagandists embedded with the Russian army publish videos they say show troops moving east, away from Mariupol. But military analysts say Russian forces in the city suffered substantially, and Moscow may struggle to redeploy rapidly to other battle fronts. One Russian commander talked of fresh territorial ambitions in the south of Ukraine, suggesting a new access route to Transnistria, a pro-Russian enclave in neighboring Moldova. It's unclear if these comments reflect official Kremlin policy. Back east, meanwhile, Russian troops continue their assault on the Donbass. Overnight, a hospital near Donetsk damaged under direct shell fire. In the city of Rubizhne, broken boulevards bear the scars of conflict. A cultural center crushed by artillery. In a basement beneath it, a dozen of the city's residents shelter together. Ludmila said she fled her home after the shells began to fall.
It was raining, the roof was leaking, the plaster and wallpaper fell off, a constant draft.
It is impossible to live in our houses. No gas, no light, no water.
To the north in Kharkiv, emergency workers on scene at a public market, smashed and torched. The city remains a top target for Russian rockets, leaving residents to deal with the daily damage. Yuri Gurupayev said two civilians charred to death inside this vehicle.
How is it different from Bucha or Hostomel? And we're told it's quiet here? How is it possible? Here are people burning. Here are two people burning. Look, bodies. How is it possible?
Despite the bombing, thousands of Ukrainians plan to return this weekend to celebrate Orthodox Easter. Like Maria Litok, who arrived today in Kyiv from Poland to meet her family.
I am now confident that the world is aware that we are strong. It is important because just a few people knew about Ukraine. Now almost every person can show the city of Kharkiv on a map.
Home for the holidays, but for how long, unclear.
Tonight, Anna, despite advances by Russian forces on multiple fronts in the south and east, in cities like Kyiv, it's not so much about clearing up as pushing back against that military aggression. The national flag is still fluttering behind me. Traffic has returned to the city centre. And with the evening curfew pushed back till late, restaurants and bars remain open for customers. But just an hour or two from where we're standing, awful scenes of devastation and destruction in many directions throughout surrounding towns and villages. Amna?
And the NewsHour's coverage of the war in Ukraine is supported in partnership with the Pulitzer Center.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. Firefighters across the Southwest are battling more than half a dozen wildfires amid intense winds of more than 50 miles an hour. One of the biggest fires outside of Flagstaff, Arizona, has burned over 21,000 acres and is still only 3% contained. The winds and extremely dry conditions have caused the blaze to explode in size.
Well, this fire is 100% a wind-driven fire. And most of the fires we get in northern Arizona are wind-driven fires. Typically, we catch the fires after the wind dies down, you know, once the wind event goes away. In the springtime, sometimes we get 5-, 6-, 7-day wind events, and that's what we're seeing here.
Guns were the leading cause of death among children and teens in 2020. That's according to researchers at the University of Michigan, whose findings were published in the New England Journal of Medicine. They analyzed mortality data from the CDC and found there were 4,300 deaths from firearm-related injuries in 2020. That's a 29% increase from 2019. Guns killed more people between the ages of 1 and 19 than car accidents, drug overdoses, or cancer. President Biden celebrated this Earth Day by taking action to protect the environment. He signed an executive order designed to help restore national forests ravaged by wildfires, droughts, and plant diseases. He also made remarks drawing contrast with his predecessor on the issue.
We're in one of those moments in world history and in American history where we've reached the point that the crisis on the environment has become so obvious, with the notable exception of the former president, that we really have an opportunity to do things we couldn't have done 2, 5, 10 years ago.
Meanwhile, environmental activists around the world marked Earth Day by taking to the streets, from anti-fracking demonstrations in Colombia and protests against oil in London to a student climate march in San Francisco. Philadelphia has lifted its indoor mask mandate, which it had reimposed just 4 days ago. The city is experiencing an unexpected drop in the number of hospitalizations from COVID.
I think that most Philadelphians have understood that there was a mask mandate and why. And I think that's what we're seeing in the data. You know, if people hadn't understood that, I don't think we would see Philadelphia data moving in the direction that it's moving, given that that's different from the surrounding areas.
Meanwhile, beginning today, Los Angeles is requiring masks for everyone passing through its airports or riding public transit. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis signed a bill today dissolving Walt Disney World's self-governing status. Disney opposed Florida's House Bill 1557, which bans the teaching of LGBTQ plus topics from kindergarten through third grade. DeSantis said Disney will end up paying more taxes. The company's control over 27,000 acres in Florida was crucial for its plans when it built the theme park in the 1960s. DeSantis also signed into law new guidelines involving race-based discussion in businesses and schools. The law bans any instruction that says members of one race are inherently racist. Opponents say DeSantis is trying to suppress black history. Overseas, at least 33 people died in northern Afghanistan after a bombing at a mosque and religious school. The explosion littered the floor with shattered glass and debris. 43 people were wounded. Officials said many of them were students. And tensions remained high in Jerusalem today as violence broke out at the Al-Aqsa Mosque for the seventh time in 8 days. Palestinian youths threw rocks and fireworks at the gate where Israeli police were stationed. The Israeli police then stormed the mosque and fired stun grenades to clear the compound. Medics said more than 50 Palestinians were wounded. The violence ended hours later, allowing thousands of Muslims to attend midday prayers. Still to come on the NewsHour, Georgia Republican Marjorie Taylor Greene faces a possible ban from running for re-election. A Michigan state senator's spirited response to an opposing lawmaker's accusations highlights a widening political and cultural divide. Essayist Margaret Rankel reflects on how we can appreciate the natural world found in our own backyards and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
France's 49 million voters go to the polls on Sunday for a second and final round vote between incumbent President Emmanuel Macron and far-right challenger Marine Le Pen. As campaigning ended, Macron cast Le Pen as a radical, while she told voters Macron is anti-France. Special correspondent Malcolm Brabant reports from Paris.
"We're going to win," chant the supporters of Marine Le Pen, who was thoroughly trounced by Emmanuel Macron in this contest 5 years ago. Since that defeat, Le Pen has moderated her hardline rhetoric to appear more mainstream. But she needs the votes of the extreme right, and as her campaign peaked, she channeled Donald Trump with pleas to make France great again.
"People of France, the moment when you can claim justice in the ballot box is approaching. The moment when you can throw away the bad memories of this reign of arrogance is this Sunday. People of France, rise up against those who have such little regard for the defense of our civilization, who have denigrated your history, your culture, your traditions, who have submerged our sole demographic prospect in immigration, who have authorized the construction of mosques and cathedrals subjected to pernicious foreign influences."
France's eternal inspiration, Marianne, who symbolizes freedom, solidarity, and equality, is draped in the Ukrainian flag. But Le Pen has been accused by President Macron of being in Vladimir Putin's pocket after her party borrowed nearly $10 million from a Moscow bank. Le Pen has threatened to withdraw France from NATO's American-led Integrated Military Command. She's also opposed to ending imports of Russian oil because she believes it would hurt France. In this election, domestic issues trump concerns over European peace. Marine Le Pen has very little support in metropolitan Paris. Rural villages and provincial towns like Arras here in northern France have become her stronghold. This is part of France's Rust Belt, which has been hard hit by the closure of steel mills and mines. Le Pen's pledges to cut the cost of living and also her anti-immigrant stance really resonate here.
"I'm not racist. I've had foreign friends who integrated better, whereas nowadays they're in small communities. They don't mix. We've had Italians, Spanish, they assimilated, they learn the language, they learn our habits, but them, no. You see that? For me, that's not France."
"From a builder's perspective, with Marine Le Pen, we can have better purchasing power, which will be great."
"What will be better with Marine is that she will save France. She's got a program."
The prospect of a Le Pen presidency horrifies those living amid the brutalist architecture of France's poor city suburbs. Saint-Denis, on the outskirts of Paris, is the most diverse district in the country.
Look at me. I'm scared because I'm a foreigner, even though I was born here. Le Pen tells me I'm only French on paper, but I'm French. That's why I'm scared.
Songwriter and composer Pedro Coyote fuses African rhythms with Western genres. He was born in France after his parents emigrated from Mali in West Africa, which is struggling with an Islamist insurgency. Despite Le Pen's assurances, ultimately, he fears deportation.
We are the scapegoats. I'm scared because I love this country. Long before me, my ancestors helped France during the Second World War, and now we're looking at the other end of the spectrum, where the right wing have said what they will do, and they will apply what they've said. Be careful. We know who we're dealing with here.
Sociologist and anthropologist Nasira Gwenif specializes in migration and ethnic minorities. She hopes that supporters of left-winger Jean-Luc Mélenchon, eliminated in the election's first round held 2 weeks ago, will vote for Macron on Sunday. What do you think the chances are that there could be a Trump-style upset and Le Pen will win against the odds?
Yeah, there might be something of that kind. I mean, if you consider that Europe is not free of all these tendencies and France is part of Europe and it hasn't fought hard enough against states like Hungary or Poland that put to the fore this kind of policies against migration, against civil rights.
Gwenif is relying on disaffected voters like 26-year-old waitress Mariama Sadio to cast their ballots against Le Pen.
Okay, parfait.
I tell you, I've got the chills. It's scary. It's scary because in her right-wing program, where do we immigrants go? What are we going to do? What are we going to become?
Le Pen's campaign is banking on unhappy left-leaning voters abstaining. Mariama Sadio falls into that camp.
Don't you think you have to vote tactically to stop Le Pen from getting in?
It could be seen as a tactical vote. I understand that. But to me, that would mean that I was for Macron, and I am not for Macron.
Centrist Emmanuel Macron has a serious fight on his hands because his five-year presidency was littered with protests, and he's widely perceived as being arrogant and out of touch with much of the population. Le Pen's surge is said to have caused panic amongst the president's strategists. Alexandre Holroyd represents Macron's party in the National Assembly.
Has President Macron been complacent in this campaign?
Absolutely not. I think that the president has been as much as a candidate as he could and has been as much as a president as he had to. And this has been an exceptional time, obviously, with the conflict in Ukraine. And he's been fully working day in, day out to try and prevent that conflict originally and to try and mitigate its impact.
Although still preoccupied with Ukraine, Macron has stepped up his campaigning in these final days.
To all the French who chose to abstain or to vote on the extreme, I want to convince them in the coming days that our project is a much stronger response compared to the far right's scares and the challenges of our time. You can count on me.
Le Pen's rallies always end with the Marseillaise, the French national anthem. This election represents the best chance the far right has ever had of winning the presidency. Yet all the latest opinion polls suggest that Marine Le Pen will fall short once again. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Malcolm Brabant in Paris.
New audio reveals that House Republican leader Kevin McCarthy told Republican colleagues he would urge President Trump to resign in the days following the January 6th attacks on the Capitol. To sort through all of this, I'm joined by our Capitol Hill reporter, Lisa Desjardins. Lisa, good to see you.
Good to see you.
So the audio we're talking about, it's a private conversation. It was uncovered by two New York Times journalists. We should mention Alex Burns and Jonathan Martin. It is a conversation between Kevin McCarthy and Liz Cheney. They're talking about President Trump. Let's just take a listen to what they said.
Liz, you on the phone?
Yeah, I'm here. Thanks, Kevin. Are you hearing that he might resign? Is there any reason to think that might happen?
I've had some few discussions. My gut tells me no. I'm seriously thinking of having that conversation with him tonight. I haven't talked to him in a couple days. From what I know of him, I mean, you guys all know him too. Do you think he'd ever back away? But what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to call him. Again, I mean, the only discussion I would have with him is that I think this will pass, and it would be my recommendation we should resign. I mean, that would be my take, but I don't think he would take it, but I don't know.
Lisa, you've been talking with Republican sources, including lawmakers. What are they telling you about this and what it means?
Well, first of all, this is the exact opposite of what Kevin McCarthy's own spokesperson said just yesterday, said that he never said he would ask the president, President Trump, to resign. But I will tell you, there's a couple layers to this. The first is the political. And talking to sources today, I don't think there is going to be a political problem for Kevin McCarthy because of this within his own party. Why? President Trump. When I talked to Republican sources, they were waiting to see what the president, the former president, would do. I can report that he and Kevin McCarthy spoke at least twice yesterday. And the readout from that, reported by others, and I have one source on this, is that President Trump is okay with what he heard. Somehow Kevin McCarthy was able to convince him, I'm still on board with you. We don't know if Kevin McCarthy actually ever did ask him to resign or if he just told that to the Republican leadership there. Mm-hmm. Another thing benefiting Kevin McCarthy is he is now the top fundraiser ever in the House Republican ranks. He raised more than $30 million just in the last 3 months. So that helps him politically. But I want to talk about something broader, what this reveals and what this means sort of on a more pervasive level. This shows what was going on behind the scenes. Kevin McCarthy on January 13th, went to the House floor and said that the president, President Trump, was responsible. But just a couple weeks later, where did he go? Mar-a-Lago, to talk to President Trump. There was this moment where Republican leaders were wondering and talking about maybe pushing President Trump out of leadership for good, and it passed. And that, this is what we're learning from these. And I think this also tells us something about Republicans and the fact that President Trump really is still driving the train and deciding the future of even potential speakers of the House, like Kevin McCarthy.
That is so interesting. We should note, this is all in the days after January 6th, that conversation unfolded. We've been seeing many more details about January 6th coming out in different reports. You've been following them all, but those have included some texts from lawmakers, including people like Republican Senator Mike Lee, right? What can you tell us about those? What should we know?
Right. These are texts that were obtained by CNN, and talking to Senator Lee's office, they have not said that these are incorrect. You know, they've tried to explain them. But here, I want to read a couple of them, what the senator was doing. He says he was looking for rationale and evidence. But one of these texts on January 3rd, he wrote, "I know this will end badly for the president unless we have the Constitution on our side and unless states submit new slates of Trump electors." Let's look at another text. He wrote to Mark Meadows, the chief of staff for President Trump, "I've been calling state legislators for hours today, going to spend hours more doing it. I'm trying to figure out a path I can persuasively defend, even if they can't convene. It might be enough for a majority of state legislators to sign a statement indicating how they would vote." Amna, that idea is about having separate slates of electors that might run counter to what the popular vote in the states were at the time. Ultimately, Senator Lee did not vote to object to the election, and his team says he ended up not finding evidence. He was really looking for it, but he never found it, and he backed down. But this is different than what we heard from in the public. And it shows you something important here, which is that President Trump, as he was holding on to power, there were others that were also part of this idea of election fraud, looking for it everywhere they could, even though there was no evidence behind the scenes. That push was happening for many political reasons. And Senator Mike Lee was kind of walking both sides there.
Very different messages in private versus what in public. Such an important story. You've been following it all. Continue to do so. Lisa Desjardins, thanks so much.
You're welcome.
In related January 6th news, facing a challenge to her candidacy for re-election, Georgia Republican Congresswoman Marjorie Taylor Greene took the stand today in an Atlanta courtroom to say she did not participate in the insurrection. She says voters should decide whether she gets a second term, not the courts. The outcome could be felt beyond Georgia, since other Republican officials face similar challenges. Jeff Bennett has our report.
Please be seated.
A crucial test for the controversial Congresswoman.
Ms. Greene, I'm just asking questions.
I'm just answering.
Marjorie Taylor Greene, the first lawmaker to testify under oath about the January 6th attack on the U.S. Capitol.
I was asking people to come for a peaceful march, which is what everyone is entitled to do under their First Amendment, but I was not asking them to actively engage in violence or any type of action.
Denying any involvement and defending her right to be on the ballot in next month's Georgia primary election.
Now they're coming after me to remove my name off the ballot.
A group of Georgia voters and the organization Free Speech for People filed a legal challenge last month. They say Green should not be eligible to run for re-election. And they're relying on a clause in the 14th Amendment to the Constitution that says no person shall be a senator or representative in Congress who, having previously taken an oath as a member of Congress, shall have engaged in insurrection or rebellion or given aid or comfort to the enemies thereof.
Don't mess with her. Don't mess with her.
They argue Green did exactly that in the lead up to the January 6th attack by knowingly repeating the lie that the 2020 election was stolen.
And we're going to fight for President Trump on January 6th.
And urging her supporters to fight for Donald Trump. They point to comments like this that Green made the night before the insurrection.
This is our 1776 moment.
She urged and encouraged and helped facilitate violent resistance to our own government, our democracy, and our Constitution.
We're going to send our favorite president right back where he belongs, in the White House.
Green remains a fierce defender of the former president.
I rise to support the objection.
And even though she objected to the vote certification in Congress on January 6th,
what's happening to these people being held in custody is wrong.
And later criticized the conditions of the D.C. jail where several rioters were being held. She has said the people that broke into the Capitol are solely to blame.
Breaking the law is unlawful. There's been over 700 people charged for what happened on January 6th.
We will fight even harder because this nation is worth saving.
A similar challenge to North Carolina Republican Madison Cawthorn was blocked by a federal judge last month. But in a 73-page ruling earlier this week, a different judge in Georgia cleared the way for today's hearing. With Green on the stand today, the clock is ticking for a ruling.
It's highly unlikely she's going to be removed from the ballot.
Amy Steigerwald is a professor of political science at Georgia State University. She says Green is likely to prevail.
This is an administrative law judge who is hearing all of the evidence, will then make a determination and a recommendation to the Secretary of State, Brad Raffensperger, who is also facing his own reelection and a very strong primary challenge. And to be perfectly blunt, needs many of the same voters who would potentially be voting for Representative Green in her election to also support him so that he can continue to be Secretary of State.
Election officials in Georgia can begin mailing absentee ballots on Monday. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeff Bennett.
And speaking of our political and cultural divides, a clash that erupted at the state level this week went viral and captured some of the national debate around these issues. John Yang has the details.
Amna, this all began late last week when Michigan State Senator Lana Tice, a Republican, delivered an opening invocation that said children are under attack. Three Democrats walked out of the chamber, including Senator Mallory McMorrow. On Monday, Tice sent out a fundraising email that included the unfounded allegation that McMorrow wants to groom and sexualize kindergartners. Tice also attacked her for what Tice called race-based education. The next day, McMorrow took to the Senate floor to fire back.
So who am I? I am a straight, white, Christian, married, suburban mom who knows that the very notion that learning about slavery or redlining or systemic racism somehow means that children are being taught to feel bad or hate themselves because they are white is absolute nonsense. I want every child in this state to feel seen, heard, and supported, not marginalized and targeted because they are not straight, white, and Christian.
Videos of the speech were posted on social media and have gotten millions of views. Senator McMorrow joins me now from her home in suburban Detroit. Senator McMorrow, thanks for joining us. I want to break down a couple of things you said in your speech. You said that you represent what you called the biggest threat to the hollow, hateful scheme that the Republicans, you say the Republicans are carrying out. Help us understand, what do you mean by those two phrases?
So these attacks that we've seen about grooming or marginalization, they impact the LGBTQ community, the Black community. It's really targeting marginalized groups, marginalized people. And what I meant when I said I'm the biggest threat is I'm not a member of a marginalized community. I am a straight, white, married, Christian, suburban mom. And if more people like me who are not in a minority group who are not under attack stand up and call it out as hateful, hollow nonsense, then we take away its power.
And talk a little bit about how you decided to respond and how you decided to respond in this way.
So I sat on it for a day. I read about the fundraising email in the morning and then really took the day to put all of my thoughts together. And, you know, initially I was just disgusted and you want to kind of hit back in the moment. But I just thought about if I felt as horrible as I did on Monday, how much worse it must feel every single day if you are the parent of a trans child, if you are a member of the gay community who gets called a pedophile or a groomer every single day. And I realized that we have to do a lot more.
Why do you think the Republicans are doing this sort of thing in general? And why do you think they're singling you out?
It's pulling this language from QAnon conspiracies. It started in the darkest corners of the internet, this idea that the government is run by a Satanist cabal of pedophiles. And we saw what happens when a gunman opened fire at a pizza parlor in DC, believing that there were pedophiles there trapping children in the basement based on this lie. But now this conspiracy is being pulled out in the open, and it is being used by one of our country's two major political parties as the official policy, the official attack, and we have to stop it. So why me specifically is yes, I'm one of the people who walked out of this speech, but also I'm not particularly shy about expressing my opinions about these things. I host a live stream every week, and I talked about why I walked out of the invocation. So I think it was a signal to anybody like me who dares to stand up with the marginalized community that we're going to paint you as one of them. You're no longer one of us. You are one of them. You are, you know, something dark and dirty and evil, and we have to take our identities back.
You talked about the incident here in Washington, D.C., where someone did show up with a rifle at a place where conspiracy theorists had these unfounded allegations that there was a child trafficking ring going on, a pizza restaurant in Washington. Are you concerned at being singled out in this way? Are you concerned about your safety?
You have to be. And I think that was one of the most hurtful things about the email that went out about me is clearly there was no thought from Senator Tysa as to what the consequences might be. And that was really scary for my friends and my family. But again, I am generally okay. I'm doing well. My family is happy and healthy. We have resources that I know a lot of others don't. And there's a sense of privilege to be able to use my position for people who are regularly under attack, who don't have the protections that I do, who are in real danger if people like me don't take a little bit of that risk and take the hit and try to push back.
Since you have gotten a lot of attention for your pushback, Senator Tice tweeted, while Senator McMorrow is on MSNBC preaching to her choir, I'll keep my focus on Michigan parents who Democrats are seeking to undermine as the primary decision makers in the education of their children. What do you say to that?
It's just sad. It's sad and pathetic that she's doubling down when other parents. I am a parent saying that you do not speak for all parents. And I know that there are thousands, if not millions, just like me, who don't want our kids to grow up in a place that is hateful and malicious towards anybody who is different.
Michigan State Senator Mallory McMorrow, thank you very much.
Thank you.
From culture clashes in Florida between the Republican Party and Disney to revelations in Washington about actions of lawmakers around January 6th, it has been a busy week in politics across the country. To navigate all of it, we turn to the analysis of Brooks and Capehart. That is New York Times columnist David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart, columnist for The Washington Post. Welcome to you both. Good to see you.
Yeah,
I want to pick up where Michigan State Senator McMorrow left off. And Jonathan, the first question goes to you. I just want to get your reaction on the accusations she faced and the way that she responded to it, because it's not something we see often. What do you make of it?
Right. I'm going to ignore the accusation because it's a lie. And it's a lie that far-right Republicans have been hurling at Democrats to cow them. What I loved about Senator McMorrow's response was how forceful it was, how she refused to cede ground, moral ground, to people who were seeking to attack her. I loved it. I'm glad you played that clip of her saying, I am a straight, white, Christian, married, suburban mom. And I loved what she said to John Yang when she said, we have to take our identities back. For far too long, people on the left, elected Democrats, have, like I just said before, cowed in the face of these attacks instead of standing up in their own, with their spines and standing on their own two feet and in their values and in their morals and saying, do not speak for me. Do not speak. I'm a Christian. Don't tell me that I'm not. I'm a mom. Don't tell me that I'm not. Don't tell me I don't care about my children or other children. I want more McMorrows out there. And she's not the only one. Last week, Ian Mackey, mm-hmm. a Michigan State representative, went at a colleague who proposed anti-LGBT legislation and said to him directly, it's because of people like you that friends of mine decided to leave the state because they didn't feel safe. And so if we had more Mackeys, if we had more McMorrows who were willing to be the voice of LGBTQ people, African-Americans, Asian-Americans, anyone who is not the straight, white, cisgender, usually male person who is attacking them, we could move this country out of this horrible conversation that we're having now.
We talk about all of this under this broad umbrella, we call it culture wars, right? And it captures a lot of different issues, including the ones Jonathan just talked about, including the one the state senator talked about. But David, specifically, she's not wrong. A lot of those ideas are very QAnon, dangerous conspiracy theory related. That used to be fringe. We still call it fringe. Is it fringe still?
I wouldn't say QAnon is fringe anymore. There's tens of millions of people who are somewhat affiliated with QAnon. So I wouldn't say it's fringe. I'd say there's two things happening here. One is the crazies. Pizzagate, grooming, all that stuff. That we can't say it's fringe, but I can at least say it's crazy. It's lunatic. And it's not only lunatic, it's cruelly lunatic, and it's barbarically lunatic. So that's happening, and she was responding. I found her a very compelling human being. Then there is the culture, and I'm not going to call it a cultural difference. If you look at the World Value Survey, which surveys values all around the world, what you find is that people in the English-speaking world and in Protestant Europe, our values are shifting, and the rest of the world's values are very different. And the same thing is happening in this country, that some of the values where people are, I live urban, educated, shifting. A lot of the rest of the country, not shifting. And so we're just seeing widening chasms on values on a whole range of issues. Mm-hmm. When to teach sexuality to school kids. And somehow we have to have that fight without it being dominated by the crazies, and frankly, without it being dominated by the gotcha screaming moments we've seen at school boards and all that. And we don't even have that fight. We need to have a discussion about this stuff. And right now it's being submerged because it's been hyper-politicized. And when you turn a discussion about difficult issues into partisan politics, you've destroyed it.
But when all of this is unfolding in a political arena, right, and you have even members take it up to the national level where you have members of Congress who sometimes say these similar things and it's not immediately rebuked by leadership, doesn't that perpetuate it?
Right, but they're not going to rebuke it because it's popular. And so, you know, Donald Trump was not a policy president. He was a culture war president. It was continual soap operas where he would identify some identity issue, and then he would own the libs. And so that's what our politics has become. It's not, do we disagree with this or that tax rate? It's our identity has to triumph over their identity. And so that we're in this, you know, doom spiral of values fought as political soap opera.
There's also this ongoing sort of dehumanizing of the political opponent, right? Which we have seen in studies, experts say, can lead to more violence. And that's part of the argument behind the examination of Marjorie Taylor Greene's role, what she said, how it led, whether or not it led to the violence on January 6th. I saw you were watching. I saw you tweeting about it. You were watching her in that courtroom today. Clearly, it's not really going to have an impact. Experts seem to say she's not going to be taken off the ballot. So what was that really about? What did you learn by watching?
Well, one, I'm glad someone is trying to hold her accountable. Because if Kevin McCarthy isn't going to do it, hold her accountable the way he held Liz Cheney accountable by stripping her of her leadership post, then someone needs to. I found her demeanor on the stand to be insulting. As if she knew she was going to get away with saying, I don't recall, even after being shown video of her saying the words she said she couldn't recall. She might not be taken off the ballot, but again, at least someone is trying to hold her accountable, because that's no one in elected leadership seems to care.
Is that accountability going to happen?
No.
Will it have an impact?
No, I've never interviewed her, but I know people who know her, and they say she knows exactly what she's doing. She's a sophisticated soap opera player playing the game of getting attention and getting on TV, which generates money for her. Attacking her generates money for her opponents. And so this is not legislative politics the way it used to be practiced, where you run for office to do something. This is you run for office to manipulate attention, and she's a master at it.
Manipulate attention, and I completely get that, and I understand the theater of it all, but at some point, someone is going to have to recognize that the rhetoric of Marjorie Taylor Greene, the rhetoric of that Lana Tice, and these other Republicans who are using LGBTQ kids and African Americans as props in their play, they have consequences. We're talking, when McMorrow speaks, when Mackey speaks, when other folks speak out against this stuff, they are fighting for the dignity of real people. This isn't just, a moral play or just, you know, political theater. People's lives are at stake, and people's lives are being played with by people who don't have those worries, don't have to worry, aren't marginalized, don't have to worry about their safety simply because of the way they look or the way they identify. And that is the problem I have with what's happening right now. And to know that Marjorie Taylor Greene actually is sophisticated and knows exactly what she's doing makes it even more insulting. She's playing with all of our lives.
We have seen Leader McCarthy face a number of questions about why he hasn't done more, right? In the past, she's attended a white nationalist conference and talk about consequences. We don't really see them. But I want to ask you about that audio tape. That was, of course, as she was on the stand there, that was being played out across the news networks. What did you make when you heard that?
Well, you can exactly predict Kevin McCarthy's position based on where the winds are blowing that particular half hour. And so there was a long period where Trump was riding high and he was pro-Trump. There was a brief little window where Trump seemed to be, maybe things were shifting, and Kevin McCarthy zoomed over, then the winds shifted back, Kevin McCarthy shifted back. And what you see is the corrosive effect first of Trumpism, which is only the current moment matters. We don't have any long-term memory. And second, the corrosive effect of so many Republicans in the Congress saying one thing in public and believing another thing in private. And when you do that long enough, you erode any sort of sense of conscience of who you are, and you wind up with Kevin McCarthy.
I need to ask you both about President Biden, because there was a lot of attention this week. We've hashed over these numbers about those dips in approval ratings. And this week in particular, you saw really come to a head the conflicting crises, compounding for sure, but really conflicting crises in a lot of ways that they're facing. There's pandemic weariness. They're trying to maintain authority for the CDC. They want to keep Russia from winning Ukraine, but they have to try to keep gas prices down. Jonathan, when you look at that, are they doing everything they can?
Yes, I think they're doing everything they can. Maybe they could do a little bit more in one area or another. The problem for the president is the message can't break through. Perry Bacon has had a great column in the Washington Post where he talked about, you know, we're at this point where no matter who the president is, about half the country is going to hate him or her, perhaps, one day. But the other thing is the right-wing echo chamber is so strong that no matter what the president does, they're not going to report on it, or they'll spin it in a way that makes him, you know, look as, you know, horribly as possible. Mm-hmm. So I think that what the White House has been doing, and I'm the nerd who pays attention to the White House press releases that says who's going where.
That's why we love you. Nerds,
and
welcome.
So, you know, the president and the vice president have been getting out more.
Yeah.
But unbeknownst to many people, the first lady and the second gentleman have been traveling around the country for months. And they're not just going to safe blue havens. They've been going to Mississippi and I think also Wyoming, but to red states to talk about either the infrastructure law or the American Rescue Plan. Mm-hmm. But when you do that, when principals like that do that, they get local media coverage. And what the White House does, as White Houses have been doing for a very long time, leapfrogging Washington and going directly to the people. Whether that is going to work, we won't know until the midterms.
Well, so a White House official said the other day, there's enough time. They get out, they message, they show people they're doing the work. It will work. Do you think it will?
Yeah, I'm a little dubious about that. But I give them credit. You know, what was history like this week, Ukraine, like what happens in the war in Ukraine maybe this month will determine a lot of how our kids live and what kind of world they inherit. China has a security deal with the Solomon Islands showing China's on the move. Like, big, important things are happening. And then somehow the political world is Marjorie Taylor Greene. And I give the Biden administration a lot of credit for sticking to what really matters. So that, once again, a big new arms gift to Ukraine. They're very focused on China. They're focused on climate change. And it may not work because we're in social media circus, but I give them credit, even on the masks issue. I think Biden's instincts are exactly right. Masks should be an individual issue at this point. It's just masks are no longer that effective at preventing the disease. Vaccines are effective. And so I think they focused on the big things, but in a post-Trump era, I don't know, they don't get a lot of attention, a lot of credit for it.
Yeah, well, we could certainly use more time to talk about all these things as well, but it's always good to see you both. David Brooks, Jonathan Capehart, thank you.
Thanks, Anna.
On this Earth Day, we turn to a writer looking at nature at risk, rhythms of Southern life, and much more through the art of the essay. Jeffrey Brown has the story from Nashville for our Arts and Culture series, Canvas.
These little blue flowers?
Yeah.
That's called bird eye speedwell. It's just a little four-petaled flower with a yellow center.
For Margaret Rankle, loving nature doesn't require trips to exotic locales. A walk in her local park outside Nashville will do very well. She calls herself a backyard naturalist.
What does that mean?
It just means paying attention to the world that you live in. Nature will, at the risk of sounding like Jurassic Park, it does find a way if we give it half a chance.
Paying attention and writing it down in the form of one short essay at a time. Many are collected in the recent book, Graceland at Last, Notes on Hope and Heartache from the American South. It was honored with the 2022 PEN America Award for the Art of the Essay.
I want to make other people fall in love with what I love. We don't work to preserve what we don't care about. We work to preserve what we're in love with.
Her first book, Late Migrations, A Natural History of Love and Loss, is a love letter to her family and to the natural world that has always captivated her. From early childhood in rural Alabama, grade school years in Birmingham, college at Auburn, and grad school at the University of South Carolina, where she met her husband, to their life together in Nashville today. She always wanted to write, first poetry, but a life writing essays, that seemed impossible.
When I was a younger writer, I wrote an essay about my then 2-year-old and how boring it was to have to play the same games over and over again. And it was called Zen and the Art of Motherhood. And it was just sort of about making peace with the moment and not the to-do list or the plans. And I got this call from an agent, and she said, you know, have you ever thought about writing a book? And I said, a book of essays? And she said, oh no, nobody reads essays. And so I was just like, I had to wait for the world to turn a little bit.
Now people do read essays, and hers have gained a large weekly following in the New York Times. Her subjects described as flora, fauna, politics, and culture in the American South. Dolly Parton just did the most punk rock thing you could imagine. I just turned 60, but I still feel 22. The boring bill in Tennessee that everyone should be watching. She refers to Nashville as a blue dot in a red state.
People say to me, don't you ever worry about running out of ideas? And it's like, how could I ever run out of ideas?
Mm-hmm. One regular subject, stereotypes of the South.
I wanted to focus on my home, my homeland. It isn't this beleaguered place that enlightened people flee.
What are the stereotypes that constantly drive you crazy?
There are so many. The belief that racism is exclusive to the South is probably chief among them. It's like, have you been in any place besides the South? More to the point, have you been here? Mm-hmm. You know, there's racism everywhere. This is an incredibly diverse region, but all you ever hear about is what's happening in the red state legislatures. It's really quite enraging.
But her biggest subject, her constant concern now, climate change and its consequences near and far. Most of us, she says, don't notice the impact of environmental change, including our reliance on chemicals to create our perfect lawns.
Even within the world of backyard nature, we are losing so much so quickly. I can't imagine that people don't notice it, because
these are things you write about, the bees, the
butterflies, the songbirds, the skinks, the tree frogs, the bats. We're losing them all. We're watching an apocalypse unfold in our own backyards, and it's alarming and it's tragic and it's heartbreaking. Everything that I care about is going to be made worse in a heating climate. If climate change continues, we're gonna lose the breadbasket. What does that mean? It means more hungry people. If what you're worried about is racial justice, you look at where the changing climate most affects people, or where the pollution is most often dumped, it's in communities of color.
Writing a book is an exercise in loneliness.
She spoke of her passions and the role of fellow writers in accepting the PEN America Essay Award.
For preserving and enriching our shared culture, for holding back the barbarians, for standing always for truth.
Many of these are personal essays, right? You're at the center of it. Strikes me as a strange occupation, you know, to write about yourself almost with an assumption that the rest of us care.
And plenty of people, Jeff, do not. and they want to let me know for sure that they don't care.
Yeah.
But I think that this is part of human nature. We want to see ourselves in others. We are an empathetic species. Mm-hmm. We are convinced when we are moved much more often than we are convinced when we are informed. That's my hope anyway.
Margaret Renkel is now working on a new book of essays that will take her and us through the natural cycles of a backyard year. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown in Nashville.
And on the NewsHour online, mobile home parks are seeing growing interest from investors who can drive up rental costs for residents. Read how one community in Fresno, California is unionizing to prevent a similar scenario. Right now, you can read that at pbs.org/newshour. Coming up on Washington Week, moderator Yamiche Alcindor and her panel delve deeper into Russia's war in Ukraine and the upcoming midterm elections. That is tonight on PBS. And tomorrow on PBS News Weekend, how sea level rise threatens farmers on Virginia's sinking eastern shore. And that is the News Hour for tonight. I'm Amna Nawaz. Join us online and again here on Monday evening. For all of us at the PBS News Hour, thank you for joining us. Please stay safe. Have a great weekend.
Major funding for the PBS News Hour has been provided by economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world. At Hewlett.org.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SkollFoundation.org.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is the PBS News Hour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.